Thank you, Dr. Ricketts. Mr. Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, Carleton graduates, to me, Dr. Corbin, whom I first met when I arrived here at Carleton many years ago, is both a friend and a shining example to look up to. And so I'm very honored to be able to introduce her to you. Her life story shows that what matters is not only what you study, such as biology or economics, but how you bring this study to bear, along with your other talents, so as to add value to our society. In Dr. Corbin's case, she translated education in psychology and statistics to a passion for understanding, through research, how and what people think. And that made her the person who brought forensic social science to Canada. In case you're wondering what forensic social science is, it is bringing marketing research to the courtroom, evidence. Her company has become the most recognized supplier of expert survey evidence to Canadian courts and government regulators. And so if anybody ever asks you, what do Tommy Hilfiger, Victoria's Secret, Jaguar Cars, Viagra, Rogers TV, what do they have in common? You might answer Dr. Corbin. Her company's evidence was used in litigation in all of these and dozens of other cases. But Ruth didn't start or stop there. She has taught at several universities, including at Carleton. She has published her research extensively, and she has chaired or served on numerous committees and boards of directors of public and private organizations, too many to mention. I could go on, but with this activity, let me say that no wonder she has been named as of one of Canada's top 100 most powerful women, top 100 women entrepreneurs. She has been on several who's who in Canada lists. And earning, of course, such accolades requires a dedication to excellence at everything that one does. To conclude, let me just give you four very brief examples of what that means in Dr. Corbin's case. One, her report to the federal government on intellectual property for the 21st century won an award of excellence for public policy impact. Two, a few years ago, she decided she wasn't busy enough with all the other things she was doing, and so she went to take a master's in intellectual property at Osgoode Hall as a mature student. And in doing that, guess what? She managed to graduate first in her class. Third, in between all of this, she found time to play the piano. And not just play the piano for fun at home, but play professionally. So she got a whole number of performance awards, including one from the Royal Conservatory, but in what I'm guessing must be her greatest pride, at the 2005 Kiwanis Music Festival, she won the first place prize in duet competition, with her partner being her own daughter, Samantha. And finally, hot off the press, just last night, we found out from Saskatoon that her company won, once again, the industry's award for public policy impact for its research on access to justice for Legal Aid Ontario. So I don't know how anybody can do this, but I do know that what we're honoring today is Dr. Corbin's contributions to her chosen profession in the context of the exemplary whole person that she is. Mr. Chancellor, in recognition of outstanding contribution to the law, especially in the area of intellectual property rights, I request that you confer the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa, upon Ruth Corbin.
By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Governors and upon recommendation by the University Senate, I confer upon you this degree, Doctor of Laws, honoris causa. Congratulations.
Mr. Chancellor, Chair of the Board, Madam President, honored guests, and graduands, I am deeply honored to be recognized by Carleton University for contributions to law and public policy. Graduands, I share your excitement of wearing this robe. What a milestone you've reached today. C'est formidable. Check out the new initials after your name, awarded by one of Canada's finest universities, in the greatest country in the world. Your parents are beaming with pride. Some of them are sighing with relief. Yeah. Remember to acknowledge the sacrifices of your parents and family in bringing you to this point of success. Their influence is sometimes invisible, yet it profoundly shapes what we drive ourselves to achieve. My own parents were survivors of the Holocaust concentration camps. My father came to Canada with truly nothing, no money, no university education, not even any English, except for four words, apple pie and coffee. Those four words got him a meal on his first day in Toronto. He started as a parking lot attendant, learned English by schmoozing with customers, bought a used car from one of those customers, and became a traveling watch salesman. He parlayed his new knowledge of watches into starting a jewelry store. His zeal for promoting quality Swiss watches eventually earned him the job of first Canadian president of Switzerland's Mondaine Watch Company. I only learned the word entrepreneur after I had been living with one for about 15 years, a man who figured out how to create new sources of value in the watch industry. How could someone bring new value to the watch industry when, after all, Swiss watches already kept perfect time? My father was the first to introduce Canadians to women's fashion watches, changeable bracelets and watch faces to match every outfit. To avoid import taxes and to beat his competitors' prices, he moved Mondaine's watch assembly operations from Switzerland to Canada. That also meant he brought jobs to Ontario long before job creation was a provincial election issue. I realize now my parents' gift to me of entrepreneurial courage. I started out as a psychologist and didn't actually become an entrepreneur until after age 40. Entrepreneurship was not a well-accepted career path for a university graduate when I was 20-something. People would whisper that you couldn't get a real job. So my career began with a few real jobs in government, universities, and corporate Canada. The day I became vice president of a bank, my father said proudly, "See, I'm glad you went to university so you wouldn't have to sell for a living like I did." But everybody sells for a living. Even when interviewing for a job, you have to sell your value to someone willing to pay for it. Entrepreneurs just take that concept one step further by creating their own job, and then they create jobs for others. By the time I was ready to start a company, entrepreneurs had become the country's economic heroes, the trendsetters, the trailblazers. The Globe and Mail called me a trailblazer. Decision Resources, the company I launched in 1994, brought forensic market research to Canada. We took a unique approach to public polling. We carried out surveys to the exacting standard of scientific research, surveys that could be relied on for high-risk decision-making in business and law. We called it market intelligence for boardrooms and courtrooms. It amalgamated what I had learned from working on surveys at Statistics Canada, on policy decisions at the Privy Council, on strategic planning at Royal Trust, on court cases for Canadian Tire and Labatt-Beer, and on high-risk decisions as a corporate director. Decision Resources grew to become the most recognized supplier of expert survey evidence to Canadian courts and government regulators. I documented the company's learning in a book called Trial by Survey, the first Canadian textbook on the subject. But I still lacked a perspective about how lawyers and judges think. So at age 53, I applied to Osgoode Hall Law School for a master's degree. And Osgoode took a chance on me since I hadn't been formally trained as a lawyer. Now I teach there. So what does all this illustrate? Every one of your life experiences lays the groundwork for your next career adventure. The accumulated learning at every stage in life can be combined, whenever you're ready, to blaze a new trail for yourself. Trailblazing is a state of mind. Do you want to develop a trailblazing state of mind, a state of mind that ensures that you will never be out of a job? Here's what you do. Create something valuable that people will pay for. Take charge of your own success. Whether in your own business enterprise, or a public company, or a government department, approach everyday tasks by thinking of something
extra you can add. Invent value that is uniquely you. If it's value that people will pay for, then financial security is yours. Margaret Atwood offers a nice homegrown example. You know she's a world-famous Canadian writer. But did you know she is also a high-tech inventor of an ingenious device called the long pen? 3 weeks ago, I attended a demo of Atwood's invention. She sat in front of a webcam in Vancouver, talking to a group of us in a Toronto salon. In Toronto, a young man placed an open copy of Atwood's latest novel onto a small platform underneath a camera and a pen attached to a robotic arm. In Vancouver, Ms. Atwood saw the image on her tablet and signed her tablet with a pen-shaped magnetic stick. She put a smiley face at the end of her signature. She hit send, and the pen in Toronto began to produce her signature on the book exactly as she had written it. Then the pen in Toronto added a smiley face at the end of the signature. Done. We in Toronto now had an original autographed copy of Margaret Atwood's new novel signed from Vancouver with the help of the Atwood long pen. What experiences led Margaret Atwood to this invention? She was tired of grueling travel to promote her books. She couldn't get to every place her publisher wanted her to be. She said she got the idea after signing for courier packages on those little electronic pads. Her passion for science fiction led her to imagine futuristic applications. So the stars aligned in her mind to invent the long pen. But then came the all-important follow-through. She registered a company to market the long pen, she created a plan, she found enthusiastic investors, she guided an engineering team, she persevered even after a public embarrassment in front of a large audience when the prototype failed to send a transatlantic signature from London, England to Guelph, Ontario. When at last the product came to market, she inspired others to invent new uses. Conrad Black used it to autograph his latest book at a major Toronto event when bail restrictions prevented him from leaving Florida. Atwood's patent lawyer exudes enthusiasm about the long pen's future for signing all manner of legal contracts. Why, President Runty could have taken a well-deserved vacation in the south of France and still have been available to personally sign everyone's convocation diploma. So, what is your future long pen story? What is your breakthrough opportunity to demonstrate original value? It depends on how you integrate your personal experiences and interests, and that will be true at every stage of your life. Your personal winning ideas can come only from you. But the good news, the best news, is that you will have no competition for being you. You're already you. You don't have to start your own business to reap the benefits of entrepreneurial thinking, but if you build a business around some brilliant concept, take comfort in knowing that Canada's laws protect ideas, inventions, and artistic creations. They're collectively called intellectual property, products of the mind. Intellectual property can be protected, just like other forms of property, through legal rights to make money when other people use or enjoy your creations. In summary, 21st century attitudes, the economic climate, and stronger laws have all converged to reward entrepreneurial courage. Your generation, like none before it, has vast opportunity to achieve financial security through creating and implementing new ideas and new benefits for people who will pay to receive them. Your Carleton education gives you the tools to take charge of your success and happiness. The path to success is full of surprises, great days, tough days, days that will challenge you to stay ambitious and optimistic. You will rely on the support of those you value most in your life. In my case, it's my parents, my husband Barry, and our remarkable kids, Daniel, Jonathan, and Samantha. One final word about your path to success, starting on this momentous graduation day. Ralph Waldo Emerson knew a thing or two about where to look. Do not go where the path may lead,
Emerson wrote. Go instead where there is no path and leave a trail. My point exactly. Start now. Every morning when you brush your teeth, decide what unique value you will add this day to your interactions or to your work. It will become your approach to life, a state of mind, a trailblazing state of mind.